panelists, I'm going to pose a question or two to each one and have them answer it, and also encourage any type of answers or continued dialogue within the panel itself. So I'm just going to kind of randomly pick some of the these questions, and I'm going to start with Richard in regards to, since we're here with collaborations and connections, talking about technology. And when I read about what we want to talk about, the term that comes up is the digital divide. Can you just talk a little bit about the term the digital divide and how your organization, the University of Maryland School of Social Work, is addressing that issue in some of the communities, especially here in Baltimore?
Sure. So the digital divide has to do with the division between the haves, the digital haves, those who can get access to the internet on a regular basis, those who are networks to others, and the digital have-nots, those who may occasionally get access, but it's not dependable because their access gets shut down because they can't pay the bills, or they can get access on a cell phone, but they don't have a network or a computer, or they have a computer that's very slow. And basically, the digital divide is now become a real civil rights issue. To be connected in this society is critical to your success, whether you're trying to pay bills or settle traffic tickets or deal with reports or have your kids do homework. You need connectedness, and you need quality connectedness. There are at least two ways that the students that we see and that we work with in West Baltimore, there are many more than this, but at least two I'll mention, what the cost is for them of having low connectedness or no connectedness. For one thing, they simply can't do their homework in many cases. So you'll see kids sometimes sitting outside the library, brother and a sister, maybe more, looking at a cell phone that's a smartphone that might have a broken screen, trying to download math tutoring programs or something that their teacher has put up on the web, and trying to figure out how to download that so they can do their homework. The other part of the digital divide that I think this group will really relate to is the investigative divide. All of us probably grew up when we had a question looking in books, and now you look on the internet. And that is a critical skill for any kind of success that you're going to have. If you can't pursue knowledge at the time you need it, then that's a huge detriment of the digital divide. And the kids who are experiencing the digital divide, and this is well more than half of all poor kids in the country, and we don't have a great estimate about what it's like in Upton or Druid Heights or Sandtown, but it's got to be no more than 20%, really have the access that allows them to be curious and to investigate and to pursue their dreams of what they should know.
Okay. I know in order to take advantage of the digital divide and to have access...
To close the digital divide.
To close the digital divide, exactly. Who can you partner with in order to facilitate this? Is there an organization in town, whether commercial or civic, that could help facilitate this, whether it's through the actual, let's say, the machinery or the device that can help bring this to some of the lower neighborhoods?
So in the sort of simplest terms, we've been clear as a nation that we should close the digital divide by helping schools to be networked since the end of the last century. So a lot of that is done, although not perfectly. Then we became aware that we should try to get families connected in the last decade. So we've been working on that some. There are a few programs that are run by private industry that reduce the cost of being connected. Certainly, in some cities, they even have trucks that go by and that you can go in and do your homework. That's the kind of thing, that's the level that we really need in West Baltimore. There have been a few projects that haven't gone very far, and I don't have the history of all those, and no one wants to hear about failures anyway. But I think the biggest efforts really are the libraries and the schools. Those are the best places for students who need to be digitally connected and to close the digital divide. And then we started a conversation with AINet. Turns out that our information technology hub for the campus is in a building that where they're leasing space from AINet. Peter Murray, who's our chief information technology officer, had some conversations with Deepak, who you'll hear from as soon as I stop dominating the mic, and they started talking about what we might do together. We have an opportunity to become a federally funded Promised Neighborhood, and we'll be applying again as soon as they release an RFP for that. And we went to AINet and said, would you help us? One of the things that's required in this proposal is that we provide 21st century learning tools to the students in our Promised Neighborhood. And there's nothing more important to that than connectedness. So the short answer to your question is, the best partner we can think of and that we're delighted to be working with is AINet.
Okay. Anita, I wanted to ask you a question with in regards to the Baltimore Museum of Industry and museums in general. It also kind of jumps upon what we just discussed, and a museum, especially one as yours, is a real serve as a repository of history, of culture, of documenting that. How would that, you feel that that type of knowledge plays into some of the roles that we're talking here in regards to looking towards the future, as you study and document the past? Can you tell me a little bit about what your museum does and how it looks forward to working with the future, especially as we think about it occupationally?
Sure. So I think that there's a lot of questions.
Just pick one then.
Okay, so I'll start with sort of what museums I think need to do today in order to be relevant and be meaningful. And that is to acknowledge that people are consuming knowledge in a very different way than they did in the past. You know, when a museum might have been beautiful objects behind a case with didactic curatorial text. People in the age of social media are much more accustomed to an interactive kind of knowledge gathering and providing feedback. And I think that smart museums have to work with that new reality so that we are conveners, that we're creating a space where people can come and have dialogue. I mean, much of what we're doing now in this forum inspired by the presence of this artwork in this particular location. In terms of the Baltimore Museum of Industry, as I said, we're really committed to talking about these contemporary issues that have to do with work and the evolving nature of work. A lot of museums struggle with relevance. We don't really feel we do struggle with relevance because we're about something that is so deeply meaningful to everybody. Everybody, you know, either has worked, wants to work, aspires to work, will work, wishes they could work. And there are a lot of really interesting, especially now in this political climate, a lot of really interesting questions about work. What does offshoring mean? What are the impacts of robotics on the workforce? How is artificial intelligence shaping the workforce? All these kinds of questions are really contemporary and really interesting. So last spring we did a series on the human impacts of deindustrialization. Next fall we're doing a whole program series on the future of work, and again we'll address some of these issues. And this spring we're doing a program series about the intersections of art and industry, which gets to sort of another thing that successful museums need to do, which is to make sure that we're interdisciplinary and really stretching the boundaries of what we do all the time. So next week we're opening an art exhibition. We're a history museum. It's an exhibition by a local machinist and sculptor named Chris Bathgate, who uses machines that are cast-offs of the industrial process, retrofits them, computerizes them. He uses them to make these beautiful, almost luminous machine metal sculptures. And those sculptures are a commentary on the intersection between art and industry. He likes to talk about the fact that with the emergence of desktop manufacturing, there are whole new ways for artists and artisans to create art that are starting to move that kind of practice from utilitarian to aesthetic. So I don't know if I've answered your questions, but I think the point is that museums need to stretch, they need to be cognizant of the way people are working today and learning today, and they absolutely need to collaborate, and I can talk about that later, but I'll stop hogging the microphone.
Thank you. Dina, I'm curious to know a little bit more, considering the contemporary. I'd like you to say a few words about how the contemporary is structured and what really pushed your organization to bring this life back to Howard Street. What really was a motivation there? Because this truly works as a collaboration between two pretty, as we see it, separate entities.
Yeah, sure. I think that maybe jumping off what Anita was saying, that the contemporary was founded with that spirit in mind, right? Like, how can an entity exist that is sort of by design flexible and responsive and nimble to the circumstances of the community and the citizens it serves? And I think it's upheld that pretty successfully over the past 30 years. So for us, I think maybe a jumping off point that would be interesting for this conversation is in our mission statement, we sort of, we believe in three core values. One is that artists matter, and we put them at the core, obviously, of everything that we do. We're an arts museum. We don't pretend or posit to be anything else. The second is that collaboration is key. Again, we talked a little bit earlier about how we're just too small. We don't have the power, frankly, to do things at the scale that we'd like to do them. And since our founding and to this day, we've done everything in collaboration with others. Sometimes those are arts organizations. Oftentimes they are not. And that's been a pretty successful model for us. And I can talk a little bit about this particular project in a second. And then the last one, audiences everywhere, has been the one that we are still sitting in a place with, right? So what does it mean to be a museum that can speak to many different audiences? Sometimes at the same time, sometimes not, right? And what does it mean to decide on behalf of a city what an audience is or can be, and how do we learn from that as we move along? So in the case of this project, when we first met with Kirby, the conversation was that there had been very little activity on Howard Street. I mean, there's some amazing things happening on Howard Street, arts activity, otherwise, all up and down this corridor. But this particular block we were looking at a lot because of the depth and breadth of the buildings that are on it and how long they had been shuttered to the public. And when Kirby had expressed an interest and a willingness to help us figure this out, and Deepak and Brian and the rest of the folks at ANET kind of came in and said, you can use the building, it then became, well, who are we speaking to on this corridor? And that's everybody from the street traffic. Do people come down here often? Can you raise your hand if you've been down here, not for this project in the past month, on this block? What do you come down here for? Somebody just shouted out for me, do you use the light rail?
LaMondo.
Fried chicken?
Okay. LaMondo, so that's an art project that's being built up on this corridor just a few blocks up. What else?
Fornos.
Restaurants. Okay, so you come down here for either entertainment, food. Lexington Market, yes. But see, okay, so I have another thing. I am talking literally the front of this building. Not Lexington Market, not Fornos, not LaMondo. I mean this exact entrance. Has anybody been down here in the past month not due to this project? Okay, see how, so what does that say about our city block to block, right? Like, people come to neighborhoods, but they don't necessarily come to individual blocks. And I think that was something at the outset that we were interested in, especially the downtown partnership. For our art project, I think another thing that was compelling for us is not just the history of these buildings, but quite literally the scale of them. We were interested, for Michael's project, in a big open space, right? And that's something we couldn't find too much of in Baltimore at the time that we were searching. So I think there's a lot of things that we were juggling mid-air to make a project like this happen. In terms of how does something like this come to life, there's so many factors involved in that. In addition to thinking about an audience, logistics, a budget, time, how do we actually make a thing? We then invite an artist to interpret something however way they want to. You know, and Michael spent roughly a year thinking specifically about this building, 3 years thinking with us about Baltimore, and ultimately decided to make a thing that I think really mirrors a lot of the conversations that are happening right now in the world, and in our country especially, around issues of excess and technology and humanity's relationship to all of these things at the same time in our memory and space. So it's a very long way of saying, I think that we're sort of designed to be collaborators, and that anytime the contemporary has tried not to behave that way, it has never worked for itself. And I think that it would be wonderful to see more of that kind of spirit in the way that our administrations and our other cities function. And I think that's what's so nice about hearing about partnerships like the School of Social Work and AINET, or something like an art museum, and ostensibly sort of a private city agency that deals with downtown. I mean, beautiful things happen. So I'll be done hugging the mic since that seems to be a theme of the evening.
No, it's interesting when I've talked about Hutzler's itself, when they moved to that building next door, it was no longer Hutzler's when it opened in 1985. I asked how many people ever went to that Palace store that was next door, and usually around 10% of the hands of an audience go up, and I say, how many people went back? and probably 10% of those hands go up. It was something that was not relevant for, it was not downtown Baltimore at that point. Looking at downtown Baltimore, I have to look at Kirby, because on a selfish note, let me just say that I make my living down at the Meyerhoff Mount Royal Arts District, and we have the Bromo Arts District, and Howard Street serves as this almost seemingly no man's land between the two. How do you see as a way to connect those two arts districts together, and also connecting, let's say, the Lexington Market area down towards the financial district? I know we had a chuckle earlier about the super block, but I'm curious to see what your vision for connecting all these different neighborhoods.
Well, you mentioned the Bromo Arts District, and that is the vision. The Station North Arts District has had great success under Ben Stone and many other people in the room here. Bromo can have a slightly different character to it. First of all, it's north-south oriented, and it's hard to connect a lot of those things along a very long Howard Street, Utah Street corridor. We have at the southern end, we have basically the theater district. In the central area, we probably will have the creative artist district, more grassroots artistic offerings. And then the northern part could be more, we have Antique Row, you have some more restaurants that you connect into, again, more established institutions like the Meyerhoff. And so you have a lot of different characters going up along the way, but we have to connect those, have the connective tissue to make it all happen. And you're right about asking people how many people go on this block, because it is going block to block. You have to build on the strengths that we have occurring here. Hopefully this project will be a catalyst for what could happen around here. But really, and some of you, like from the current space, we met last week to talk about the 400, 500, 600 blocks of North Howard Street. And talking about collaboration, we brought in all the different property owners and users of those blocks just to first talk about what they're doing. You have to have the knowledge first to move on to the next steps. But there's a great center of activity happening in the 400, 500 blocks, and with LaMondo current space and with the residential and more. So you got to build on that strength. But maybe this will be the opportunity for us to build on the strength in these blocks. Everyman Theater is seeking some additional space just a block from here. And Lexington Market will have some new life coming soon. So we have to fill in the pieces first, but we have to have first the core. And again, I think the 400 block is going to be very strong, the 500 block is going to be very strong of Howard Street. But if we can get back to the collaboration just for 1 minute, there's two things I think that we have to do, and I've been thinking prior in preparation for today's session. One is that we need to get out of our silos a little bit. You know, I'm not going to blame the internet for this, especially since ANED is the sponsor of this event today. But it seems like we're talking to ourselves a lot. And so it's important to get out of our silos and bump into people. And it's important to get out and see each other. And so, you know, we have Dina, who's connected to the artist community, and I'm connected to the property owners. And if we didn't connect through different people we knew or through different social activities, perhaps this we wouldn't have connected together to lead to this. And the second thing is you have to challenge your own assumptions, because I assumed before Ginevra, Dina, and I went and met with Deepak that he would never agree. I didn't even know him at all, but I assumed, okay, he's a property owner on Howard Street. No one's really thought in a progressive way about Howard Street for a very long time. And so we go in, and I'm ready for a stubborn reaction, and instead he almost embraces us from the start, and you don't have that very often. So I think getting out of our silos, connecting with other people who don't necessarily fit in our social circles necessarily, but connect and then challenge our assumptions too.